future of the role of HRBP. And it's great to welcome you all for this discussion after a grand success we had of our last BeNext program on the role of HRBP in the new world of work. We had over 100 leaders from around the world registering for this five-week intensive development and acceleration program. And I think it's a great opportunity for HR teams to reboot. And using the BeNext five-week program, it allows each one of you not only to develop in and learn new ways of thinking and new tools that you can use in your business, but it really also is an opportunity to invest in your own acceleration and work with leaders from across the world in that program. So on popular demand, the course is going to start again on 20th of September, and I'm very, very excited to share with all of you that we're going to have the program available in Spanish and English. So our colleagues in Spain, in some countries in Latin America, will be able to choose if they want to do the program in English or they want to do the program in Spanish. So I'm very, very, very excited to announce that the HRBP in the new world of work will be available in two languages this September. So let's start with today's conversation, and we have a very privileged, it's a privilege to have one of our exclusive guests, and he's also the leader of the masterclass in the HRBP program. He's ranked as number one management guru by Business Week. He's profiled by Fast Company as one of the world's top 10 creative people in business, in the top 5 coaches by Forbes, and recognized as well as the Thinkers 50. And none other than Dave Ulrich is here with us today. A very warm welcome, Dave.
Esther, what a privilege to join you. And thank you so much for inviting me into this BeNext program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dave. So Dave is a university professor, author, speaker, management coach, management consultant. He's also the professor at business at Ross School of Business, University of Michigan, and the co-founder at the RBL Group. So thank you so much, Dave, for being with us. And today, we've heard you speak, of course, a lot about HR is about creating value to stakeholders. And the more and more I speak to CEOs and CHROs, the more I'm realizing that we are all struggling to take a stand on how do we define this world of work and what does it really mean. On the one hand, employees are saying they don't want to come back to office. I was talking to one CEO last week, and he was saying 70% of our employees don't want to come back to office. But the management and the business are still saying, we want you back in office. So how do you see, what are some of the most progressive companies doing to find a balance of this new definition of work?
You know, I start the definition of work not with the activity. And to some extent, I'm less concerned about, am I in the office or not in the office? I think that's in some ways a great question, but it's not new. Many of us, and Esther, I assume you as well as I, have worked, we've traveled, we've worked in hotels. In fact, the first book I wrote, I dedicated it to the Toshiba laptop computer, without whom we could not have written the book, because I wrote the book on an airplane. So offices are very mobile. What's interesting to me to start the world of work, past and future and present, what value do we create for a customer? If we don't create value for a customer, there is no work. There is no workplace. If you don't succeed in the marketplace. So where I love to start the future of work, who are our customers? What are we doing to create value for them so that they will buy our product or service? And then we create the workplace that enables that to happen. And so the first discussion is not, where do I work? The discussion is, how does my work create value? For example, I care less about where people work and more about what did you do today that will create value for a customer, either today or in the future. So if I'm doing something on an airplane, in a hotel, in my home, in a coffee shop, that creates value for a customer, that's good work. And that's where I love to start, is what do we do to be successful in the marketplace by then creating a great workplace?
So in this discussion, a lot of organizations, especially I've seen that in some pockets, local pockets, have the hurry to say, let's have that discussion even in office. Let's bring people to office and then let's think about how do we serve our customers. And there is a threat as well there on losing some segment of your population that may need more flexibility and so on and so forth. So as we get into that discussion of what value are we creating for our customers, we also need to have the speed to define some kind of contours of what's our philosophy in terms of how we may serve our customers. Do you feel that's an urgency, or you think let's just focus on the customer first, as always?
Oh, it's obviously an urgency. I mean, early in my career, I focused inside out. We build inside and then we succeed outside. Now I focus outside in. The fact is the outside customer and the internal employee need to come together. And what I think that means is if we try to serve our customers well, we then, what can we do with our employees so that their focus is on creating value for customers? Now, some of that's going to be done in an office because offices create cohesive cultures and social cohesion is so critical. Right now, people are talking about the grand resignation and people are leaving. Well, that doesn't serve our customer well, because if our employees turn over, then the relationship between the customer and the firm is sometimes lost. I don't think managers should be resigned to the resignation. And some of that resignation is we join not just to do the work, but to be part of a team. And so hybrid work means there is a time to come to the office to be part of the team. The difference for me is a bit subtle. Don't come to the office just to do the work you did at home. Don't come to the office and sit in a cubicle isolated. Come to the office to collaborate, to create, to be cohesive. So when work is done in the office, we need to think about it differently. Office work is not just doing the work you could do in isolation, in a cubicle by yourself. It's a cohesive culture that we're trying to create. And then what we find is employee retention goes up because employees stay with other employees. Guess what? Employee retention is a lead indicator of customer retention. And that's an indicator of some profitability. So that value chain between employee experience, customer experience, and investor experience is a wonderful place for HR to go. I see a lot of HR people just talking about build the employee experience at home or in the office, but unless and until that delivers customer experience, it's going to be an event, not a sustainable pattern.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thanks, Dave, for bringing that outside in and inside out, and finally remind us that if we retain our employees, that is the indicator for customer retention and profitability.
So let me give an example.
Yeah, go ahead.
I get to interview Esther. Esther, what will you do today that will help a customer of People Matters? What will you do today? You've done it. Your day is mostly over. What have you done today? And it could be today a customer. It could be I envision a customer somewhere in the future having this experience because of what have you done today?
So today we actually had a capability building session for our senior program leaders on how we may scale up the way we serve our customers in our digital business.
Were you face-to-face or were you virtual?
We were virtual.
And you know what? That matters less than what you just said.
Yeah.
Because if your program managers can work with you, and I'm, by the way, this was not scripted, but if your program managers can work with you, either virtual or face-to-face, then we will build programs that our clients and customers will come to.
Correct.
And we at People Matters will help create that future for them. That's the logic. And it does matter where we work because social cohesion is so critical.
Yeah.
I don't come to work just to do a job that I could do at home. I come to work to be part of a creative community. And I hope someday your program managers come together and you have that social work and that face-to-face, which is so critical.
Yeah.
But the question starts with, what did we do today that a customer will benefit from? And then hopefully we'll find the right place to do it. I'm sorry to take us, but that's an example of what I want to talk about in our master's class. How do we in HR think about work that way?
Wonderful. Thank you, Dave. And in the masterclass, you will cover some of those elements about how do we structure that inside in to affect the outside inside out.
Absolutely.
Tell me a little bit about that social cohesiveness in terms of maybe the opportunity that we have to change the way we structure ourselves, the relationships we have with our people managers, the relationships we have with each other. So what is this new definition of organization that we have the opportunity to break from the past and create a new. The same way you were saying, we will not go back to office and do the same job we're doing at work. When we go back to office, we also don't need to have the same HR we had before the pandemic.
You know, I love to think about, and there's a lot of words that sort of mean the same thing. People talk about culture, social cohesiveness, climate. One of the pieces is our values. Do we, and the behaviors that flow from our values. If we value innovation, then we take risk. We try to be creative. If we value collaboration, we come together as teams. So there's values. The other piece has been called in the research climate, which is, what are the processes that shape around how we treat our people, how we manage information, how we manage conflict, how we make decisions. Those processes begin to be part of that social cohesiveness. The other part of social cohesiveness is simply the patterns of work. How do we talk to each other? How do we connect with each other? All of those pieces create a social cohesiveness, or a culture, or a capability, whichever word you want to get. The piece I'm going to go back to, and by the way, I'm beating the same message, that internal culture should reflect our external identity. For example, I was just talking with a senior HR executive, and he said, we're trying to build a brand in the marketplace of creativity. That's our advertising. That's our promotions on the internet, on media. We're trying to be known as the most creative company. And I don't want to name the company. That wouldn't be relevant. What does that then mean inside the company for how we hire people, how we pay people, how we train people? What does that mean inside the company for how we make decisions? What does that mean inside the company? And so that external identity or brand begins to be an embodiment of our internal culture. And when that happens, we tend to be more successful. You're in HR. You want to build that internal social cohesiveness that connects with external. Somebody pointed out, final comment, HR is obviously about people. We care about people. We are in HR because we work to help our people succeed. Guess what? Our customers are also people. That's a resounding duh. So what we do with our people inside should be consistent with what we do with our people outside, our customers. And when we build that bridge, it becomes helpful. Final example, this senior HR person I was talking to said, here's my HR agenda going forward. I've actually got it on notes because I just had the call. I want to build leadership and well-being and global talent. I mean, and performance management. We all have those. And he said, any comments? I said, how will those internal HR innovations, leadership, compensation, accountability, well-being, give your customers a better experience? And if you put it through that customer filter, it will help you focus some of those activities. Again, I've hit this outside in the last 14 minutes of our conversation. I'll let it go. But that's the agenda for HR going forward. The future of work is not what I do. It's how what I do creates value for those I'm trying to serve.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thanks, Dave, for that. And you were mentioning about that conversation and the focus on well-being. And I'm reminded, and again, that's a question we had not discussed. So I'm just curious to know about the element of well-being. And this leader I was speaking to, he was saying that the biggest issue that we will have will not be economic opportunity or will not be customer growth. It will be the burnout of the last 18 months and the consequences that may have. And I'm curious to know your opinion on what HR and HRBPs in particular, because those are closer to teams and business leaders, how to navigate this burnout ghost.
Yeah, it's such a key issue. I bet, Esther, if I ask you, I'll ask myself. In fact, there are times in the last 18 months, I'm home. I'm not having to commute. I'm not having to travel. In fact, all the research shows productivity seems to go up because we avoid some of those distractions. But it's tough. We work on holidays. We work at nights. We feel an emotional distress that we've never felt before. The demands are high. So what do we do to give our employees a resource? Because if you have a high demand without a resource, you're going to get burnout. If you have a high demand with a resource, we're better. In that resource area, it's not a new topic. I get frustrated a little bit when HR people say, oh, it's all new. No, we've given employees resources before. We call it satisfaction. We call it motivation. We call it commitment. We call it engagement. Now we're calling it well-being, or the word that often gets used is employee experience. How do we give you an experience? Again, in my world, I love to simplify complexity. I'll talk about that. My research in the university decades ago was taxonomy. How do you take complicated items and make them simple? We've identified three things that an HR person can give an employee as a resource to cope with demand. One is belief, meaning, purpose. Am I doing work that has a meaning and purpose for me? So as you and I, Esther, create ideas, I love to think about the ideas we create having a positive impact on those who listen. I mean, somewhere in our fantasy mind, we say the ideas we're going to share in the BeNext program, someone will have a better experience at work. And I believe that. That's learning. That's what I believe in. Do I create belief in an employee? Second, does the employee become better? Does my experience at work help me learn, help me grow, growth mindset, whatever you want to call it? Am I learning? In the last 18 months, I've never had so much learning. I would not go online because I've been told by so many people, you have a voice for radio and a face for internet, and do not do a visual. I've given up. Welcome to my office. Yeah. Guess what? I scratch. I have a bad hair day. It is what is. I've learned how to go beyond that. Believe, become, and belong. That's the social cohesion. I'm even going to scratch my nose in a public forum. That's the social cohesion we care about. We are social animals. The highest predictor of well-being in a person is the relationships we have. That's studies that have been done by many people. So what does that mean? I'm in HR. In the future of work, I want my employees to have a good experience, whatever you want to call that. Do I help them find their belief? Do their values match our organization values? Do I help them become better, learn, grow, develop? And do I help them belong as part of a community? Again, that's a really simple threesome, but believe, become, and belong give me a sense of what we're going to want in this talent. And by the way, if we can do that, this great resignation that somebody said 20% of people are going to leave, which is possible. I think they're leaving because they're seeking belief, they're seeking becoming better, and they're seeking belonging. But if we can provide that, we will retain the very best.
Beautiful. Thank you, Dave, for sharing that. And I love your opinion and how we are going to cover that as well in the masterclass. Because the believe, become, and belong is not one initiative. It's not one activity, or it's not even a set of activities. It's a complete change on the way we look at talent. So how do we break this huge elephant? It's just not an initiative or one activity. It's actually a way of leading, which is different.
I love ideas. There's an old movie, and he was one of my favorite actors, bless his soul, Robin Williams. And I don't know if people around the world have seen him. He did a movie called Good Morning Vietnam, where he just threw out ideas. He was one of the most creative people. I wish I had that. But every once in a while, you got to structure the ideas. Let me give you the structure. In the master's class, we're going to have one idea. That's simple. HR is not about HR. HR is about helping your organization succeed in the marketplace. That's the outside in we talked about. To get there, there's three pathways. Pathway one is changing the way we think. I've got to define my success in a different way. It's not what I do. It's the value I create for others. Pathway two is what I contribute. And I'm going to suggest I contribute three things: talent, organization, and leadership. My fingers, everybody who knows me now is saying, I can do what Dave does, but I'll remember it. It's talent, my fingers, organization, my fists, they come together, and leadership. Under talent, we're going to talk about believe, become, and belong. So it's a subset of talent. We're also going to talk about organization. Am I creating the right culture? We're also going to talk about leadership. How do I distribute leadership in this new world? Path one is the assumption. Path two is the contribution. And path three is what we have to do in HR. Again, back to my stupid hand gestures, talent, organization, leadership. The forearms represent the HR services. My department, my people. What do I do in HR to sustain those three things? That's the flow of the masterclass. One idea, three pathways, and very specific tools with our assumptions, our contributions, and HR.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thanks, Dave. And we are really looking forward to learning those pathways with you during the masterclass on 30th.
And but I have a request for those.
Go ahead, Dave. Yes.
One of my passions is to learn. Come with questions that are hard, and Esther will answer them. and don't come expecting an answer. Yeah. If you come to the master's class saying, give me a brochure that has the six steps to heaven, don't come with those questions. Come with the questions that are difficult. And let's co-create in that framework. Again, I do want a framework. This isn't Good Morning Vietnam, whatever goes.
Yeah.
HR is not about HR, assumptions, contributions, HR. But if you come with questions, let's dialogue, let's co-create. Somebody asked me yesterday in a session, it happened to be at our church, where do leaders lead from, the front or the back? And my answer was neither one. Leaders lead from the side. And we sit with you and partner with you. So the metaphor, I hope, in this master's class, I'll be in front with some ideas. I'll be behind learning from you. But I hope I'll be at your side, co-creating with you about ideas that may help us learn and grow. So I just want to get that out. Don't expect very simple cookbook answers.
Yeah.
Come with tough ideas, and we'll try to co-create what we do next.
That's so lovely, because I think that's just really the philosophy of those 5 weeks with those masterclasses, and yours being the core masterclass of the course, but it's just about finding solutions together and co-creating it. So thank you, Dave. So my last question is related to HRBP as a role. And I think you were, the father of the HR structure, and you've been always in the forefront, again, simplifying complex through taxonomy. And the HRBP was just a fantastic way to really help HR seeing themselves not as HR for HR, but HR for business. And that's why HR has business in that role, HR business partner. So we'd love to invite you to reflect about how do you see that role evolving, and why do you think it's so important to invest in the HRBP function going forward?
Great question. There's a saying in French, and I should have you say it, Esther, because you'll say it better. Plus ça change, plus c'est la même. The more things change, the more they're the same.
Yeah.
HRBP as a principle is the same. We're not, somebody said, HR is not BP, the HR people are leaders. Well, I don't think I want to go to the business leader and say, hi, I'm from HR, I'm the business leader. I mean, we're not the business leader. We partner with the business leader to co-create a future. Nor do we sit behind and react. We learn that navigation process. So that process is going on. I think the things are changing dramatically around us, that there are things we in HR need to know and do. What I also love is research. I am a professor. We do research at the Ross Business School and elsewhere. We have just collected data from, by the way, in the HR field, a lot of people say, do analytics. And then we propose our analytics and they say, I don't like your responses. Well, that's what analytics is about. It's about discovering new ideas. So we have data from 29,000 people. What are the set of skills for HR to create value? We discovered five things, and we'll talk about these. Number one, by the way, we've done this research for 30 years. We always defined it as a role. You're a business partner, a strategic contributor, a credible activist. That's an adjective and a noun, credible activist, business partner. We've now defined them with verbs, which is an interesting tweak because the verb is action. First, accelerate business. If I'm going to be a business partner, I've got to accelerate business. Now, what do I need to know and do to do that? We'll talk about that, and I could go through it. On this hand, I accelerate business. On this hand, by advances in human capability. So let me say those two actions. I accelerate business by advances in human capability. And human capability, you're going to hate me again, is three things: talent, organization, and leadership. So that's the connection. Accelerate business by advancing human capability with three connections. One, mobilizing information. In this age, we've got to have information. We've got to have data, structured data, unstructured data. Two is fostering collaboration. We have learned in our research that it's the relationships that work more than the structure. Whatever the structure is, we've got to have. And three, the third connecting mechanism between accelerates business by accelerating human capability, mobilizing information, fostering collaboration, simplifying complexity. Simplifying complexity, which requires theory, research, and practice. Those are the five things we found for HR Business Partner going forward.
Awesome. And we're so looking forward going deeper into each one of them together on the 30th of September. So thank you very much, Dave.
Esther, I'm going to ask you a final question.
All right, go ahead.
You're the host and you get to sit in this seat and have so many. What either excites you or scares you? You can do the same question about the next generation HR. You've done so many courses through People Matter, BeNext, these programs. You sit and listen to so many people. Yeah. What excites you and or scares you about what's next, about the BeNext for HR? And I'll end with that, my question to you.
Oh, very good. So what excites me is that we have a golden opportunity to break from the past, because we have the buy-in, we have all the expectation and desire for freshness and for novelty, and that's what excites me. I think what scares me is our ability to be more courageous. Do we want to take that plunge? Are we willing to make those mistakes? Because you will make mistakes as you go through. So that's what scares me, that are we going to have the courage to take on that big opportunity that we have as a function?
That is so exciting. I love both of those. Thank you.
You're most welcome, Dave. And thank you for being with us. And we're so looking forward to welcome you once again on 30th of September for your masterclass and continue to learn from you. It's a pleasure and a privilege. And thanks, everyone, for joining us today as well for this exclusive conversation. And it's always so refreshing and inspiring to hear Dave. And thank you, everyone, for being such a participative audience as well. So I want to share a little bit about the upcoming, and Dave was talking about the BeNext program, and he's been contributing and supporting us on the first cohort that we did for the HRBP. But I'm going to take a step back for some of you who may not have heard about BeNext yet. And I've prepared a very brief presentation just to run you through what is BeNext and what is cohort-based certification programs. So very quickly, we launched a year ago, and BeNext is a platform for development and acceleration. We have already certified 4,000 learners from 32 countries. We have a total of 18 programs that we have already launched, and some of them are repeated, like the one that Dave was talking about the HRBP in the new world of work. We did the first batch in the month of July. We're doing now the second batch in September. It starts on 20th of September. And some of those programs repeat because we see a huge ability for us to make an impact, and they come back on popular demand. We have over 86 instructors from 12 countries. And the most exciting thing is, of course, our completion rates and repeat learners that talks about the importance of cohort-based learning. And I'm going to explain to you in a minute. And all our programs are accredited by HRCI. And most progressive companies are sending their HR teams for transformation and development, and using the BeNext program not only for learning and development, but as well for acceleration of change and transformation. So what makes BeNext different? Number one is, of course, the cohort-based technology. BeNext is a proprietary platform from People Matters, and it has the learning is bidirectional, which means that you're doing the course with a group of leaders, and everything that you're doing in the course is visible to others, and it encourages that accountability, because you're able to really, really contribute, and your contributions are visible to everyone. And that makes everyone a lot more responsible. It makes us a lot more fun and more accountable as well. The second thing that makes BeNext very different is we have a 5-week journey, and every week there is a lot of work you do on the platform asynchronously, but every week you also have a live session. So week one, you have the onboarding session where you get to meet your cohort leaders. On week two, you have the masterclass. On week three, we have the power hour, which is just a conversation with top leaders on the big dilemmas that you have. Then week four, we let you focus on your project because you're going to have to work on a project that you need to submit. And week five, we come back on the final live session, which is really about sharing what you learn and presenting to each other what are the actions and the plans that you're going to take into consideration in your context. Third, as I was saying, the 5 weeks are divided into four pillars. So week one is about reflection. where we invite you to think about why are you doing this course, why are you doing this program, what do you want to achieve, and what are some of the tensions in your business that you want to attack. So that's going to be week one focus area. Week two, we focus on learning new concepts, new templates. You're going to have a lot of exercises and assignments for you to work on in your context. Week four is we're going to push you to invite you to work on a project plan on what is it that you're going to implement in your organization. And the end in mind of week four is to enable you to work on a project that you're going to either present to your business team or your HR team to implement. And that's really the outcome of the five-week acceleration. And the last pillar is the contribute, where we invite you to give feed forward to each other. And it's a mandatory component of the course. So you need to give feed forward to at least two learners for you to complete the course. And that's a mandatory part as well. So that makes BeNext different. Fourth, of course, is accredited. So we go through a very rigorous process through HRCI. So all our courses are accredited by HRCI, and you'll get the credits for recertification in both the global category and the business category as well. And the final element is that it's accessible and inclusive. It's, of course, adding the feature for specially able learners. So it's screen reader, dyslexia, text size, contrast, and other accessible features as well. So this is all I had to share with you. The upcoming program is going to be both in English and Spanish, and it's starting on 20th of September, which is the HRBP in the New World of Work. And that's going to be an opportunity for you to meet not only Dave, but a series of other HR and business leaders that we've invited for that cohort. And you'll be working with a group of leaders from around the world. So inviting you to use this opportunity. And as Dave was asking, what is my dream and what's my fear? I think my dream is for us as a community to be able to take on this opportunity that we have to redesign and rethink work. And the fear is that we need to do it now. Inviting you and your HR teams to join us for the HRBP in the New World of Work, I think it's a course that can really help change a lot of those paradigms. And you'll have access to the community that will help you do so, our speakers and our mentors that will help you do so. And it's a five-week acceleration of that change. So looking forward and excited to welcome you all for the program that starts on the 20th. See you.